Hey, what's up guys, Pablo Munoz here. Welcome to another video tutorial. Today I'm going to show you how to create a nice looking embroidery patch using ZBrush and one of the new features of Adobe 3D Sampler. Let's go ahead and jump straight into it. All right, so here we are inside ZBrush, and I just created this hoodie as a testing object using Marvel's Designer, but the focus would be here on this nice embroidery patch. So look how rich this is in details. And I'm going to show you a kind of like a non-destructive way of creating these things with the new tools from Adobe 3D Sampler. So this is what we're going to be creating. I'm just using the CVG's logo just as a reference. But let me just show you as well the render of how this looks using Marmoset. So, you know, pretty cool stuff. Let's go ahead and get closer here. So you see, it reacts to light using just normal. But this is just a plane, and that's the part of the process or the point of this video, that we're going to concentrate on a non-destructive workflow so that we can basically replace it with anything you like. So I just have this other logo here, and this is from the Ultimate ZBrush Guide course. It's just my the logo for my introduction to ZBrush, which if you're interested, I'll just put a link in the description as well if you want to take your ZBrush skills to the next level using the UCG. But anyway, the point is that you can create this type of really cool embroidery patch in just a few steps, and it looks pretty, pretty cool. All right, so let's go ahead and start with the process. So what you need for this tutorial would be ZBrush, any version of ZBrush, it doesn't really matter, and the 3D sampler. So 3D sampler is this one that I have in here. And the third thing that you need is some kind of image, preferably with transparency, but it could be absolutely anything. So I have it here in Photoshop. This is a simple object. It has transparency. This is the logo for the CVGs. So I'm going to be using this as an example. So let's go ahead and jump into 3D Sampler. And in 3D Sampler, we can just go ahead and click on File, New Project. I'm not going to save this. That's it. So this is what you will see at the beginning. I'm also going to change this 3D object just so that it's easy to see what we're going to be creating. I'm going to click on the viewer settings, and I'm going to select a plane. So that's probably the easiest one, but you can use anything that you want. All right. So now, if you're familiar with 3D Sampler, usually you just drag and drop a texture or an image, and it will create a material for PBR workflow in just a few seconds. This time it's slightly different. I'm just going to go ahead and click on this add layer, and I'm going to type embroidery. This one right here. So this is one of the, it's been there for a while, but now there's some really cool new things that you can do with it. So nothing really happens, right? It's just a black image. So it kind of like disappeared the 3D object. But the only thing you need to do is drag and drop the image that I have here in Photoshop into this image input. So I'm going to go ahead and do that. Just drop it in there. And just by doing that, we already have our embroidery. So you'll see the height map, the roughness, the normal, right? I'm just going to look into the height because that's kind of like the easiest way to understand what's happening. And you'll see here in the 3D viewport, we have a nice embroidery, and it reacts to the light. Holding the shift key and the right click as well allows you to rotate that environment. So that's it, like really, really simple. Obviously, we can go ahead and tweak it a little bit more, and that's what we're going to be doing now. But in just a couple of clicks, you can get an embroidery patch, and you can just export this as a series of maps. Base color, normal, roughness, all of that good stuff. All right, so the first thing I want to do is select the color count set to 1 because we only have one color. And as soon as I do that, you see we have this little dot. If you have multiple colors, this is really helpful to select the color that you want. But in this case, we just have one, so I'm just going to drag it in there. The next slider is the stitch density, so we can increase that so that we have more stitches. So I like to have maybe a few more, just like that. Just play around with these values. There's no like right or wrong. It will be different depending on the object or the image that you use. Now, the outline threshold doesn't change things too much. I mean, you'll see that things will variate slightly. But I'm just going to click on this to reset it. I'll come back to this one in a second. Just make sure that the mode embroidery is set to fill. There are other options like outline. So it's just going to create an outline, or the fill and outline is going to create the same thing, but pretty thick in this case. All of this can be changed. But for now, I'm just going to concentrate on the fill. And let's go ahead and scroll to the fill stitching. And you can change it from satin to twill. I prefer satin, but if you want something more like this type of pattern, you can totally do so. By the way, if it is a bit too strong, this is just the displacement of the Substance 3D Sampler. You can change it from here, but you can also change it from here. So you can just change the scale in there. I'm going to leave it as it is and instead go here to the Advanced. And in the Advanced tab, you can change the normal intensity. You can change the height position as well. So you can tweak all of that, right? I think, this generally works. So I'm just going to go ahead and undo that and just leave it as it is because you know, this is not necessarily relevant to the process that I'm going to show you next. All right, so let's go ahead and set it back to the setting. So we have a nice height map here, and that's it. You can also play with the fill thickness. I think it's looking good. And the amount of imperfections, if you reduce it, is going to be pretty straight, or you can push it forward and add a little bit of imperfection. So just play around with those values. All right, so that's it for this first step. Let's go ahead and click on add layer, and I'm going to type embroidery. I'm going to create another one. And let's do the same thing. I'm just going to drag and drop the same image in there. So we have like a duplicate. But this time what I'll do is, let's go ahead and set this back to one. Instead of having it as a fill, I'm going to click on just outline. So it's kind of like having the same option of fill and outline, but separate in two different layers. And that way you have a lot more control. So one is going to create that outline and the other one is going to create the fill. Now with the fill, with the first layer, I'm going to go ahead and reduce the thickness a little bit. And that's just going to push it down. So you'll see that in the height map, in this image, this area looks a little bit darker, or like a darker gray. And let's go back to the first one now, and let's go ahead and play with the outline. So I'm going to increase the density, and I'm going to change the outline threshold, and that's essentially changing the thickness of it. You can also add a bit more imperfections to that, or reduce it, whatever you want. And the other cool thing is that if we go to the stitch finish, let's open that one up, we can enable custom color. So we can give it a different color. That's how you can just combine things. And this is just two separate layers. You can add more if you wanted to. All right, we can make this a little bit more rough and more metallic as well. So you can control the materials separately as well. All right, so again, in this viewport, it's a little bit too exaggerated, the effect, but I'm just concentrating on this image. This is the image that we're gonna need. Also, you can click on the normal and see that that's what we have. And you know, if you wanna do something in real time, like what I have here in Marmoset, that's essentially what I use. Let me just show you. We'll come back to this in a second, but I have this object and the normals is the one that is giving me that really cool sort of embroidery effect. I also have ambient occlusion, by the way. But you know, this is what I'm getting from the normals. All right, so that's kind of like what I have in here. And that is it. You can play with these whole settings a lot more, but I just want to keep it very simple. And once you have the embroidery or the patch the way that you want it to, all you need to do is save this image. So I'm going to go ahead and right click, save as a bitmap. And I'm going to call it CBG's logo, or let's call it alpha actually. And as a PNG is fine, let's go ahead and click save. Now, at this point, this is all you need to do for the next step that I'm going to show you in ZBrush. But if you want to take this a little bit further into a real-time engine and render it like I did in Marmoset or something like that, you can also go ahead and export the roughness if it is different or the normal. We can go ahead and save this as normal. And in this case, I ended up using two colors, so you can also save the albedo. So let's call this one albedo. And just for the sake of demo, let's go ahead and click on ambient occlusion as well. And save that ambient occlusion. All right, so now let's go back to ZBrush, and I'm just gonna go ahead and clone this actually, so that we start with something clean. So now that I have this base mesh, and this base mesh could be absolutely anything that you want, you can just attach it to any type of surface, but I'm just gonna use this. I think it's just relevant for the type of object that we're creating. Let's go ahead and click on append, and I'm gonna click on plane 3D, and it's just a simple plane 3D. I'm going to go ahead and use my gizmo to push that forward and scale it down. So this is the idea with the non-destructive workflow, or the non-destructive way of working in this case. So the idea is that you can use this simple plane and map the images or the textures that you created in 3D Sampler and just place this one whatever you want. So I'm going to start like this. And by default, this 3D plane that comes with ZBrush, it also comes with a pretty clean UVs. So we don't have to create UVs or anything like that, but you can do that as well if you want to change the type of object. So what I want to do now is go to the texture palette and click on import. And I'm going to go ahead and import the albedo. So just the color. There we go. So here is the color. And you see it has that black background. And now let's go ahead and scroll down with the plane selected. Let's click on this texture map and let's select that. And because of the way that ZBrush works, it will come like this, like upside down. So what I'm going to do is go to the texture and select it again and click on flip V so that it flips it. And let's go ahead and select it here again. So now it is flipped. And let's go ahead and turn off the polyframe like so. And obviously, we don't want to have that black color. So all you need to do is from the texture palette, I'm going to increase this transparency. And you'll see that now it is transparent. So ZBrush basically takes anything that is pure black and it makes it transparent. So I'm going to also enable anti-aliasing a little bit. That is essentially how you can import those textures. Now, in order to get the nice sort of details into ZBrush, what I'm going to do is use the surface sub palette. So this is the one that I have here. I'm going to go ahead and click on noise. And we have you know, just noise. And the first thing I want to do is click on the UV, and that way it just projects whatever noise we have in this case. And I'm going to reduce the noise to zero. I'm also going to set this strength by mask to zero, and no color blend, so set that to zero as well. So basically we don't have anything right now happening. And all we have to do now is click on this alpha on and off, and I'm going to select the height map. But before I select that, let me just show you something else. I went ahead and also flipped this so that it matches what I changed in ZBrush. I mean, you can totally import this as an alpha within ZBrush and then flip it as well. But because we're going to use this in the surface noise, it is easier if you just take the output of 3D Sampler, flip it vertically like I did, and save it as a copy. So I'm going to import that one so that it matches perfectly what we have in here. So let's go ahead and select that. And there we go. So again, I'm going to make sure that this mix bass noise is set to zero so that it doesn't mix it with any other noise. And then I can just go ahead and use the strength. And you'll see now using the strength basically gives me that information because it's using that that alpha and it's matching the flipped image. All right, something like this. Let's go ahead and click OK. And now we have it in there, which is pretty cool. Right, so we have all those details recovered. Right now, this is just, again, a simple plane with texture. So those details are just noise. If I turn off the noise, we won't have it in there. We only have the texture. So that is really, really cool. So we can, you know, at any point, go back to 3D Sampler, change the logo, export a couple of images, and update this. Now, there's a couple of ways to make this flat plane feel that is kind of like following the surface of whatever object you have. You know, one way would be to just select something like the project or the Z project and then use a large brush and then just project that like so. And you'll see it sort of like works pretty well. So that's one way of doing it. You can also use something like the matchmaker and then just, again, click and drag a few times until it sort of matches the surface. That's a little bit more wonky. But again, there are a few different ways of doing it. But I'm going to show you my favorite method and the one that I think works really well. So I'm going to go ahead and switch my brush to the transpose cloth, right? So this is a gizmo or transpose tool that actually reacts to dynamics. So let's go ahead and drop the dynamics in there. And the only thing we need to do in dynamics is enable the collision volume so that ZBrush knows what are the objects that we wanna use to collide with this object. So before I do that, I'm just gonna click on this inflate and set it to 0.1. Like so, and this inflate is essentially the distance or the repelling distance between the other objects and the one that I'm going to move with dynamics. So a 0.1 would be pretty good, but you can just reduce it if you want to. And you see it automatically enables this collision volume, so it basically calculates that. So now, if I slowly start pushing this back, this is going to interact with that hoodie pretty well. All right, that's it. If we get closer, you know, the distance is pretty minimal. That's the 0.1 happening, the distance between the patch and the hoodie. And that's it. That's pretty much the whole tutorial. So it's a very simple technique, but I think it's really, really powerful. Now, the cool thing and the reason why I call it kind of like a non-destructive workflow is because we can go ahead and simply update all of those things really quickly. So for example, you can just go to the texture palette and import a new set of textures or images that you created in 3D Sampler, like a different patch. And I'm just going to import the UCG logo just to give you a different idea. So I have this one that has like different colors. And I'm going to go ahead and select it from here. And I toggled off the noise because it doesn't match. I'm not going to import that. So, you know, I think you get the idea. So in this case, you can also import the height map here in the noise. Right now, I'm using the other logo, but you can import this logo as well and update it in here. And that's all you need to do. Because at the end of the day, you only have a simple plane. So you can just keep updating these with different textures. You know, and if you want to place it in a different position, actually what you can do, let's go ahead and duplicate that one just to keep that one in there. And let's go back in time before I projected it. There we go. So you can keep this before you project it and then duplicate it and just always have it there in case you need it. But then I'm going to use this one and let's switch to the normal gizmo. I want to scale that down. Maybe a patch for the shoulder would be cool. So I'm going to put that in there. Just try to rotate it and facing the area that I'm going to use to project it to. All right, that looks cool. And now we got to switch to the transpose cloth. I'm going to make sure I recalculate just in case. And then I'm going to push this down slowly. If I do it too fast, it's just going to go through the clothes. But that's it. We have a pretty cool object now. All right, and that's pretty much it. So if you want, you can just bake all of that and export it, and then you'll have a nice kind of like patch in a render like this. All right, so that's it for today. Hopefully this technique is of help. Let me know if you have any questions in the comments below, and don't forget to subscribe and turn on the notifications so that the next time that I have a new tutorial, you'll be notified. So I'll see you in the next video. Cheers.